us about the design or analysis of purlins. Okay, for this sample problem number 12, so we're given a truss shown in the figure, which is part of a roof system supporting the following loads. So as you can see from the figure, we have a 12-meter span truss with a height or a rise of 1.3 meters. And the length of the bottom cords are at 1.5 meters each. And as you can see, there are purlins, wide flange purlins placed at the joints on the top cord. So we have a total of 5 purlins on the left side and another 5 pieces of purlins on the right side naman. Okay, so the following loads were given. Roof covering on roof surface is 0.72 kilopascal. So ito yung pinakabubong. Roof live load on horizontal projection is 960 pascal, or that is 0.96 kilonewton per square meter. The wind load is 1.15 kilopascal or pressure. Now, ano ibig sabihin ng roof surface at horizontal projection? Let's say if you have this slope, this is slope. No, kunwari, this is the slope. So theta. When we say roof surface, yung load natin is nakamount siya sa inclined. So ito yung sabihin ng roof surface. So vertical pa rin siya, vertically downward yung direction niya, pero nakamount siya sa inclined. So ito yung roof surface. So usually, yung roofing, roof surface siya. Kasi nakamount naman talaga siya sa slope eh. Pero dito sa roof live load natin, it is given that it is in horizontal projection. Pag horizontal projection, so horizontal naman siya, ganyan. Siyempre, gravity load pa rin siya, vertically downward pa rin yung direction niya, pero naka-horizontal projection siya. Horizontal projection siya. So, parehas silang gravity load in such a way that the directions are vertically downward. Pero yung effect niya dun sa surface, yung effect niya sa purlin would be different. No? Kapag ka sinabing roof surface, imumultiply mo yan para kung gusto mo ma-solve yung uniform load sa isang purlin, pagka roof surface, imumultiply mo siya sa inclined spacing between purlins. Inclined. Pero pagka horizontal projection, imumultiply mo siya sa horizontal spacing between purlins naman. So, yun yung magiging difference nilang dalawa. Sa code, sa project nyo, diba? So, sa roof live load, you could get it from the UBC code or from the NSCP code. Usually, yung mga roof live load na makukuha mo doon are based on horizontal projection. Okay? So, unless otherwise in-specify siya, always assume that it is on horizontal projection. Then of course, yung wind load perpendicular sa surface. The trusses are spaced 4 meters on center. So itong 4 meters na yan, spacing daw ng trusses. So kung may truss ka dyan, may truss ka ulit rito, yung spacing nila, 4 meters daw. So yung spacing between trusses, that will correspond to the length of the purlin. Diba? Nakapatong kasi yung purlin sa ibabaw ng dalawang trusses. So basically, yung 4 meters, yan yung magiging length ng purlin. Check the adequacy of W 6x12. So given na yung size ng purlin natin, 6x12. A992 steel, whose FY is 345, medyo mataas. And the purlins are placed at the joints, as I've mentioned a while ago. Then sagrads are placed at mid-span. Okay, so meron daw sagrads at L over 2. Assume compact section. So, hindi na natin i-check yung compactness. Tapos daw, all loads passes through the shear center of the section. O, ano sabihin nun? Pagka nagpa-pass through sa shear center, sabihin, no torsion. Wala tayong torsion na i-consider. The minimum diameter of grade 33 sagrads, design also the minimum diameter of the sagrads and tie rods needed. Grade 33 means yung FY niya is equal to 33 KSI. This is for sagrads and tie rods. Then the properties of the section, yung 6 by 12, were given from the table, taken from the manual. Okay, so we're asked to check the adequacy. So titingnan natin kung pass or fail yung double 6 by 12 na gagamitin as purlin to resist the given loads. Okay, first is we have to identify all the given loads. So basically, ito yung free body diagram ng purlin natin. So we have to identify the total gravity load, dead load and live load, at saka wind load. As you can see, sabi sa problem, all loads passes through the shear center of the section. So ang shear center ng I section is nasa neutral axis niya. So nandun, nagpa-pass through daw lahat ng loads. So we need to check for the adequacy. So we need to check this interaction equation. If the sum of the bending about X tsaka bending about Y, the sum of which should be less than or equal to 1 para maging adequate. So first, I solve for the spacing. Diba may purlin tayo rito nakalagay dito. Tapos yung next purlin nandito siya. So yung spacing dito 1.5, ito yung given. Ito yung length ng bottom cord eh. Diba? So kung H is 1.5 meters, I'll be solving for the inclined spacing. Again, yung H, that would be also the horizontal spacing between purlins. Tapos yung S, that would be the inclined spacing between purlins. So magkaiba yung H tsaka sa S. So let me solve first for the theta. Yung theta would be the slope of the top chord. Okay, so masasolve naman natin yung theta, that is 1.3, yun yung rise. Yung rise ng truss divided by 6, yan yung kalahati ng span ng truss. So 12.22 yung angle. So knowing theta, knowing 1.5, I could solve for the S. S is the spacing. Yung spacing, yan yung gagamitin natin tributary width. Okay? Inclined tributary width. Tapos yung H, yan naman yung horizontal tributary width. So let us identify the dead loads. First, I solve for the purlin self-weight. Diba, binigay yung section, yung W6 by something, tapos nandun sa baba yung manual. So makikita mo dun sa steel manual yung weight niya. Ito yung nakuha ko dun sa steel manual, 18 kilogram per meter. Kailang kilogram per meter? So mass yan. So i-multiply mo siya ng gravity para siya maging weight. Kilogram meter per second square is actually newtons. I-divide mo na 1,000 para siya maging kilonewton per meter. Ayan na. Kilonewton per meter na yan. So gravity downward yan. Next is we have the roof cover. So it was given at it's 0.72 kilopascal. O kilopascal is kilonewton per square meter. So imu-multiply ko to na 1.5348. Bakit 1.5348? Yun yung S, spacing. Kasi tiba yung roof cover, kung mapapansin mo, this is on roof surface. Diba yung roof cover na 0.72 sabi is on roof surface. Roof surface means naka-inclined siya. So dapat yung tributary width mo should be inclined also. And the tributary width inclined is 1.5348. So yun, yun. Kaya naging 1.105 kilonewton per meter na siya. So gravity yan downward. Parehas nitong self-weight. Ano pa? How about yung, so pagka tinotal mo yung dalawang yan, the total dead load would be 1.28. So in-add ko lang silang dalawa. Again, these are just service dead load pa lang. Hindi pa yan factored. How about yung live load? Para sa live load, yung roof live load. Sabi, ang given yung roof live load na 0.92, diba? So 0.92 kilopascal, kilonewton per square meter. So para kumakuha yung roof live load para sa isang purlin, kukuhain ko siya sa tributary width. Ano ang tributary width sa live load? Di ba sabi natin ang roof live load daw is expressed in terms of horizontal projection. Sinabi din sa problem, di ba? Horizontal projection. Kaya ang imu-multiply mo rito is yung horizontal spacing or horizontal tributary width para sa isang purlin. And that is 1.5. So sana na nakita nyo yung difference ng roof surface tsaka horizontal projection, ha? So we got 1.44 kilonewton per meter na. Again, this is gravity, so pababa. So dead load tsaka live load, tapos na tayo. Next is wind load. Okay, so given yung wind load na 1.15 kilopascal din. Kilopascal siya. Eh ang wind load, diba, normal siya, perpendicular siya sa surface. So imumultiply mo yan sa inclined tributary width kasi naka-inclined din yung wind load. Eh. Kaya 1.534 mo siya imumultiply. Inclined tributary width. Okay, so yung S. Kaya naging 1.765 kilonewton per meter na. And direction nito is perpendicular to the surface. Hindi siya parehas ng direction ng dead at saka live load. So, hindi mo pwedeng pagsamahin sila basta-basta kasi they have different directions. Ang pwede mo lang pagsamahin dito, yung dead at saka live load kasi they are both vertically downward. So, ito yun, yung gravity load. Tapos, yung wind load, ibang direction. Kaya, hindi mo sila pwede basta-basta pagsasamahin. Okay, yung next is, if a factor na natin yung mga load. Since we have a combination of dead, live, tsaka wind load, so the most critical load combination would be 1.2 for dead, 1.6 for live, and 0.5 for wind load. So, ibig sabihin, sabi ng code, kapag may combination daw na ganito, dead, live, tsaka wind load, yung effect ng wind load is being decreased by 2. No, nakakalahati, 0.5. So, unahin ko muna yung dead load tsaka live load kasi since they have the same direction, vertically downward, so 1.2 of the dead load, total dead load, plus 1.6 of the live load. So, yan yung gravity load ko. Tapos, yung wind load, isa-separate ko. Yung wind load ko, sineparate ko kasi they have different direction. So, sa wind load, 0.5, di ba? 0.5 of wind load, so 0.5 of the calculated wind load, so I got 0.88. Okay, so identified ko na yung gravity load tsaka wind load. Now, yung gravity load, vertical siya eh. So, kukuhain ko yung normal component niya at tsaka tangential component. Okay, so para sa normal component, this would be gravity load cosine theta plus yung wind load itself, diba? Kasi that is normal component. So, I got 4.63. Tapos sa tangential component naman, that would be the gravity load sine of theta. Wala nang wind load kasi ang wind load is para lang doon siya sa normal component. So, I got the tangential load would be 0.81 newton per meter. E di alam ko na ngayon yung mga uniform loads. So, kuhain ko naman yung mga numerators, no? Yung MUX tsaka MUY. For MUX, parating WL square over 8 kasi walang effect ang lateral support, walang effect ang sag rad when it comes to MUX. So, kaya W normal, L is the length of the purlin for meters, square over 8. So, I got 9.2 kilonewton per meter. Now, ano naman yung MUY? Maximum moment about Y. Diba sabi sa problem that there are sagrads at midspan? Okay. O, pagka midspan, ano ang maximum moment? If you could still recall. Anong maximum moment kapag bending about Y, tapos may sagrad dito. Diba yung sagrad dito, parang sumusuporta siya, nagiging support siya, thus it makes the beam indeterminate. So, by three-moment equation, the maximum moment would be W, kung gusto mo ng WL square over 8, dapat small letter L. Wherein yung small letter L would just be capital L over 2. Ayan. W tangential, small letter L, square over 8. Okay, so yung ito yung W tangential, tapos yung small letter L is capital L over 2. Capital L is the full length, 4 meters over 2, square over 8. Okay, this could be also the same as W tangential, capital L square over ilan? 32, diba? Pares lang yan. Yung capital L should be 4 meters. Divided by 32, yan din yung bibigay na sagot sa atin. So, okay na tayo sa numerators. So, how about yung mga denominators? Okay, what is the design strength for major axis? So, yun yung phi, m, and x. So, since the problem says that the chosen section is compact, so hindi na tayo mag-check ng compactness, no? So, compact na siya antimano. So, tapos yung LB natin, 2 meters. Bakit 2 meters yung LB natin? Kasi nga, may lateral support, eh. May sagrad dito sa gitna, eh. So, yung 4 meters na span ng purlin, naging 2 meters na lang kasi nga, may sagrad. So, ang unsupported land natin is 2 meters. So, 2 meters is 2,000 mm. So, we have to solve for LP tsaka LR para ma-check natin yung lateral support condition ng beam. So, I solve for LP. So, that's the equation for LP. So, I got 988 millimeters. So, that's 0.9 meters. Meter. Tapos, yung LR din. So, I solve for H sub O. I solve for J using the equation. So, I solve for L sub R to be 2985 millimeters or that is 2.9 meters. So as you can see, yung LB natin na 2 meters is in between LP tsaka LR. In between siya. So kung in between siya, therefore, our beam is partially supported. Pagka partially supported, ano ang MN equation natin? So yan yung MN equation natin. No? So I solved first for the MP or the plastic moment. I got 46.92 kilonewton meter. Then substituting all the values, pati yung CB, so solve na natin. Ang nakuha kong MN is 49 kilonewton meter. So as you can see, 49 is greater than the limit of 46. So therefore, it doesn't comply with the limit. So pagka hindi siya nag-comply sa limit, anong gagawin? So you will use MN equals the limit, MP. And that would be 46.92. So yun na yung gagamitin nating MN. Okay, so okay na tayo sa MNX. No, MNX. Tapos yung phi, madali lang naman yung phi, 0.9 lang naman siya. How about for MNY? Ayan, so for MNY. Again, sinabi sa problem that the section is compact. Okay, so compact. So pagka main, minor axis, compact section, FYZY lang naman ang MNY natin. So FY is 345, ZY is section property of the section, 38. Section property and from the manual. So we got 13.11. We just have to check it with the limit. Anong limit ng MN? 1.6 FYSY. So 1.6 FYSY, 13.8. So pasok naman. Yung 13.11 is less than 13.8. So okay siya. So yun, tapos na tayo. So we'll just substitute everything dun sa interaction equation. Ito yung interaction equation. Okay, so substituting all the values. Okay, the left side of the equation is 0.2541, which is less than 1. Therefore, the chosen section, yung W6 by something na in-investigate natin is a safe section. Okay, so ganun ang pag-a-analyze ng Perlin natin. Okay, pero if you will look at the value of the interaction equation. Pag tinanong ko kayo, give me the value of the interaction equation, the answer would be 0.2541. So, yun yung value ng interaction equation. As you can see, 0.25 is masyado malayo sa 1. So, yung sabihin, safe nga yung section, pero hindi siya economical. Para mo masabi na economical yung section, yung value ng interaction equation niya, dapat malapit sa 1. Kung kaya mo ma-produce nga yung 0.99 is less than equal to 1. Diba? So, safe yun. At the same time, most likely, that would give you the most economical size of your Perlin. Mas malayo sa 1, like nito, 0.25, 0.3, medyo malayo pa yan sa 1. Eh. So, isipin, pwede mo pang bawasan yung size ng section para mas maging economical yung design mo. Although safe na siya. Pero from this problem kasi, ang tanong lang is, check the adequacy. So, isipin, pinapacheck niya lang kung pass or fail lang. Hindi naman niya sinabi na if fail or if pass, you have to redesign it based on the most economical size. So, ibang usapan na yun. Ibang solution na yun. Okay, how about for the design of the sag rod and the tie rods? So, sag rods and tie rods are designed as tension members. Tension members. So, if you could recall, ano uli ang failure ng tension failure? Diba? It is on gross area, GSY, gross section yielding, or kaya NSF or net section fracture. Since ang sag rod at tie rod, wala namang mga butas yan, no, para lagyan mo ng holes. So basically, ang failure niyan would be gross section yielding. Okay, GSY. Okay, for the sag rod first, the tension on the sag rod is given by 5.8 WTL. Saan to nakuha? Ito yung naalala nyo, diba may sag rod sa midspan? So yung reaction dun sa gitna, yung reaction dito, yun yung gagamitin mong tension sa sag rod. So, pag kinuha mo yung reaction dito, that is 5 over 8 WT times L. So, sinubstitute ko lang yan. Yung WT, na-solve na natin. Yung L, again, is the length of the Perlin. So, 4 meters. So, 2.03, yan yung tension sa sag rod, kilonewtons. Bakit ko tinimes ng 5? Bakit ko minultiply ito ng 5? Ito, yung 5 na to. Kasi yung 2.03, yan yung tension sa sag rod doon sa pinakababang, diba, kung ito yung top chord natin, diba may sagra dito sa pinakababa, may sagra dito, ay sorry, may Perlin dito, may Perlin dito, may Perlin dito, may Perlin dito, hanggang sa tuktok. Yung 2.03, yan yung tension doon sa pinakababang Perlin. So habang umaakyat yung Perlin, nag-accumulate yung tension. So isipin, yung Perlin dito, yung tension sa sagra dito is 2.3, 2.03. Pagdating dito sa pangalawa, times 2 na, times 3, etc. So, ang pinakamalaking tension sa Sagrad would be yung Sagrad dun sa pinaka-ibabaw sa tuktok. Since meron tayong limang purlins dito, so, tinimes ko na lang siya ng 5. Yung 5 dyan is the number of purlins on one side. Kaya naging 10.16 kilonewtons. Yan yun yung tension sa Sagrads na. Okay, so alam mo na yung force. Pag alam mo na yung force, edi for the Sagrad, design strength should be greater than the ultimate strength. And the design strength for gross section yielding is, di ba, 0.9 yung resistance factor sa GSY? Naalala nyo pa rin ba? No, yung quiz 1 natin, 0.9. Tapos yung PN doon is FYAG lang. Should be greater than or equal to PU. So substitute mo lang, yung FY natin is yung FY ng Sagrad. Given sa problem ng FY ng Sagrad is 33, grade 33 daw eh. Grade 33 is 33 KSI para siya maging megapascal, 6.9. Tapos yung gross area is pi over 4, diameter of the Sagrad square kasi bilog naman yung Sagrad. Tapos yung PU, ito yon yung 10.16. Kilonewton siya, ginawa ko lang siyang newtons kaya may times 1,000 dyan. So from this equation, makukuha ko na yung kailangan na diameter ng Sagrad, which is 7.94 daw ang minimum diameter of the Sagrad needed. So round it up to whole number, so I got 8 mm. So 8 mm na round bar. So yan yung gagamitin ko na Sagrad, 8 mm na round bar. Now, next, how about sa tie rod? Okay, yung tie rod, diba ito yung bubong natin, diba ito yung mga, kunwari, purlins natin. Purlins. So, ito yung purlins natin. Purlins. So, yung Sagrad, ito yung Sagrad. Ito yung Sagrad sa left side. Ito yung Sagrad sa right side. Yung nasa ibabaw ng rod na to, ito yung tie rod. No? Ito yung tie rod. So, basically, this is a rod that ties the two Sagrads at the two sides. Parang siya yung nagtatali dun sa dalawang Sagrads. Kasi without the tie rods, walang pagkukuhanan ng strength yung dalawang Sagrad sa dalawang gilid. Okay, so paano dinidesign yung tie rod? Okay. Ayan, so paano nakuha yung equation na yan? So if we will draw it, ito yung slope, no? Let's say, ang section natin is wide flange section for the purlin. Ayan. So ito yung tension sa Sagrad, tawagin ko siyang T sag max. Tapos ito yung tension sa tie rod, tawagin siya T tie rod, T tie. Horizontal 'yon. Tapos meron tayong reaction dito. Say normal force. Okay, so 'yan yung free body diagram nung purlin dun sa tuktok. Okay. So pagka force triangle natin 'yan, pag finorse triangle natin yan, so I have the T tie rod horizontal. So ito yung T tie rod horizontal. Tapos yung T sag is pag ganito. So ito yung T sag max. Tapos yung normal ito. Pag ganun. Ito yung T sag max. Yung normal, perpendicular siya rito, no? Ito yung normal force. Okay. So, kung ito yung degrees, ito yung theta. So, nasaan yung degrees dito? Ito yung theta rin, di ba? Pagdating dito, nasaan yung theta? Ito yung theta. So, basically, ito rin yung theta. So, you see, so right triangle to eh. So, kung right triangle yan, so that means cosine of theta. Cosine of theta is adjacent, T sag max. T sag max divided by hypotenuse of the triangle is the T tie rod. So, sabihin, yung tension ta tie rod, kaya natin ma-solve as equal to T sag max divide natin ng cosine theta. So, ito yun. Okay? So, yan yung pinanggalingan niya ng equation ng T-tie rod. Okay, so substitute natin. Yung T-sag max, yan yung times 5 kanina. Kaya 10.16 kilonewton. Cosine theta, theta is the slope of the top chord. So, we got, ito na yung tension sa tie rod. So, therefore, mas malaki, no? 10.41 kilonewton yung sa tie-rod, 10.16 lang yung sa sagrad. So alam mo na yung pwersa sa tie-rod, edi ano relate? Tension gross area. So 0.9 resistance factor for GSY, FYAG. So 33 pa rin yung grade FY ng steel tie-rod natin. Tapos yung AG is the area of the plane rebar. Tapos ito yung load. So therefore, we could solve for the diameter of the tie rod. 8.04, rounded up, say 9 mm. Kaya lang wala namang 9 mm na rebar, na plane rebar. So I decided to round it up to 10 millimeter based from the commercial size available. So di bali, yan na yung diameter ng tie rod natin sa ibabaw, 10 mm. Tapos yung sag rod natin kanina, ilan ba? 8 mm lang. Okay? So that is how we design sag rod and tie rod. Again, pagka nagde-design tayo ng purlins, it's more of parang checking adequacy. Parang mag-a-assume tayo ng size, tapos we check the adequacy. So sa project nyo, ganun na ganun yung gagawin nyo, no? So you're just going to check an initial section size, then you check the adequacy. Then on the design of purlins, kasama na rin doon is yung pagde-design ng sag rods tsaka tie rod. Now, so always remember that yung pagpo-provide ng sag rods tsaka tie rods, ang effect niya dun sa purlin is yung bending about y-axis. Kahit anong lagay mo ng sag rod sa purlin, pagka bending about x, wala siyang effect. So mapapansin mo, kapag yung purlin mo nagfe-fail siya sa minor axis bending, ang remedyo doon is maglagay ka ng sag rod. Okay, so initially, dapat maglagay ka ng sag rod muna sa midspan. Kasi check mo yung purlin mo kung adequate na. Pag hindi pa rin adequate yung purlin mo, kapag naglagay ka ng sag rod sa midspan, maglagay ka naman ng sag rod sa third points. I-check mo ulit yung purlins mo kung papasa na. Pag hindi pa rin, pwede rin quarter points. Ibig sabihin ng quarter points, tatlong set ng purlin. So L over 4, L over 4, L over 4, tsaka L over 4. So, hindi ko na naibigay, wala akong formula na maximum moment kapag ka quarter points na yung purlins. So, kayo na bahalang, quarter points na yung sag rods. So, kayo na bahalang mag-derive if that would be the case. Okay? So, pagka bagsak pa rin siya sa quarter points, wala na. I mean, you better increase the section of the purlins na. Hindi na yun kakayanin ng paglagay pa uli ng another set of sag rods. Okay, so usually as a minimum requirement sa pagde-design ng purlins, lagi dapat may sag rod at least at midspan. Okay, so that is how we design or analyze purlins, including the design of the tie rod and sag rods. I hope you have learned out of this presentation. So thank you.